It's my honor to call upon Padma Vibhushan Dr. Raghunath Anant Mashelkar sir to enlighten us with his words of wisdom.
Dr. P.D. Patil, Honorable Chancellor, Dr. D.Y. Patil Vidyapit, Dr. O.P. Kharbanda, the guest of honor, Dr. P.N. Rajdan, the Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. Ramesh Bonde, Dr. Deepak Kulkarni, Supriya Kheur, Dr. Vag and Dr. Mishra, whose presence I want to specially recognize because NCCS, National Center for Cell Science, started and the research that began in cell science under their leadership almost 3 decades ago. I think it is wonderful that they are here in the audience, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I must say, it has been a very special day for me. I had a visit to the facilities, I had the visit to the hospital, visit to the library, and it's incredible what I saw. I think Dr. P.D. Patil does not believe in first class, second class, third class. He only believes in world class, one class. Everything that I saw was amazing. One wonders why students have to go abroad. The kind of facilities that you have provided are absolutely incredible. You know, visionary leaders don't follow best practices. They create next practices. Dr. P.D. Patil is creating the next practices. Visionary leaders don't leapfrog. We always say we must leapfrog. What does the frog do? First of all, why does he leap? Because he's afraid of the predators. What is the average distance to which it can leap? 4.6 feet. What is the world record? 7.2 feet. Why should you leapfrog? Because you're afraid of something of around 7 feet leap. Instead, you take a pole whose size could be a few kilometers and you just pole vault. Dr. P.D. Patil, you are not leapfrogging, you are pole vaulting. And I must thank you and congratulate you. Deepak, he has been an old friend. I have seen him grow like this. I still remember 6 months ago, you are coming to me in my office and talking about your dream on stem cell research. And it is incredible the kind of support that you gave with an immediate yes. I still remember our conversation in the Delhi-Pune flight just for 30 seconds. And that was good enough for you. And within 3 months, this laboratory was created. I think it's a combination of great visionary leadership, hard work, your team, Professor Ramesh Bonde and all of your other colleagues deserve a big, big round of applause. Let me give in the next 15 minutes or so my own perspective about the importance of what you're doing. If you look at public health, what are the first thing that improved public health? It was sanitation. Then came preventive medicine, vaccines. Then came antibiotics, which were curative medicine. Then came predictive medicine, gene therapy. And now we are talking about regenerative medicine. So can you see the journey from sanitation to preventive to curative, right, to predictive to regenerative? Now if you look at India, I find myself in a contrary. The whole world changed because of sanitation. And we still have a Swachh Bharat mission to make sure that we build toilets and we use toilets. In fact, paradoxically, Dr. Patil, I chair the Committee on Swachh Bharat, Technology Expert Committee, which is looking at technologies that are affordable, scalable, sustainable, rapidly deployable, and socially acceptable. So on one hand, I'm chairing that, which was the beginning of change of public health. And today, I'm inaugurating the regenerative medicine. So there are two Indias which exist. On one hand, battling with the problem of sanitation, which other countries have solved a few hundred years ago. And at the same time, we are riding on a wave of a new technology. And that is why I always say, it baffles me. We do Mars orbiter mission, $74 million. US does it in $671 million. We do it 10 times cheaper, all right? And yet, we are circling Mars. We are looking at Mangal, and yet, girls don't get married because they have Mangal. That is the contrast that India today has, basically. So I think it is extremely important that by building scientific temper, we move into the 21st century as quickly as possible. And what we have done today are those steps on moving into the 21st century. So that is why you deserve double congratulations. I want to say that I'm not an expert in stem cells at all. I must tell you that straight away. But my first encounter with stem cells came in a very interesting way. The year was 2005. In November, I received at the hands of George Bush Sr., the former President of India, the award called Star of Asia. I was the first scientist to receive it. But not really the first scientist, because that year, the award was also given to a scientist from South Korea, from Seoul National University, Hong Woo Suk. On the day of the award, he did not turn up. Why he did not turn up is very interesting. You know, Hong was considered as a superstar, as a great researcher in stem cell research. In Science, he wrote two papers. The first one was 12 March 2004. What had he done? He had successfully created an embryonic stem cell with somatic cell nuclear transfer method, the first reported success in human cell by cloning. And this was considered impossible due to complexity of primates. And he claimed that he had used 242 eggs to create a single cell line. That was March 12, 2004. Then, on 17 June 2005, Professor Karbanda, he wrote another paper in Science, where 11 human embryonic stem cells were created by using 185 eggs. And that was considered as a breakthrough. Why? Because the 2004 stem cell was created with eggs and somatic cells from a single female donor. 2005 stem cell, the second research paper, was created with somatic cells from patients with different age and gender. What it meant was that every patient could receive custom-made treatment with no immune reaction, if this was true. And therefore, and also the success rate was 14 times higher. And therefore, this was considered as a major breakthrough. And that is why he was given the Star of Asia Award, by the way. In fact, he was given the Proud of Korea Award. In fact, Time magazine in 2004 named him among the top 20 most influential people in the world, because they said Hong has already proved that human cloning is no longer science fiction, but a fact of life. And then what happened? When the actual ceremony took place, I appeared there to receive the award, and he did not. You know why? Because it was proved that all his data were fake. And it became one of the greatest controversy in science. I won't go into the whole story, but what I'm trying to say is that the competition to be the first, the competition to do something by which, you know, you'll be considered as a pathbreaker is so high that many times the principles of ethics are set aside, basically. You know, this is a brilliant example of what not to do as we move forward. And therefore, the first point I want to make is that in stem cell research, ethics comes first, patients come first, and therefore the ethical guidelines that ICMR and DBT actually tried to create. In fact, I was the president of Indian National Science Academy during 2004 to 2006, and during that time in Hyderabad, we had a meeting getting everybody together. Indian Council of Medical Research, Department of Biotechnology, researchers, industry, and so on and so forth, because there were a lot of misuse, you know, that was basically happening. And I'm happy that we have now created, of course, guidelines we are using, I mean, giving permissions for therapeutics and the rest of it. But I think it is extremely important to understand that this is a very sensitive area, a very delicate area, where we cannot compromise human values. I think that's the first point I wanted to talk about. The second point I want to talk about is, Deepak, I must say that in research, it is important to be a pioneer. It is important to be first. It is important to have a distinctive advantage so that we don't become me too. And my personal understanding, although it is limited, I think the regenerative potential of dental pulp stem cells is huge. Why? Because it is a rich source of mesenchymal stem cells. It is suitable for tissue engineering applications. These cells differentiate into different cell types, whether it is odontoblasts, neural progenitors, osteoblasts, chondrocytes, adipocytes. They're highly proliferative. And you can see the advantage of multipotency, accessibility, and most importantly, no immunogenesis, basically. So therefore, you are starting from a big, big, big advantage. And I think that is wonderful. And you must leverage it fully. There is one point that I want to emphasize, that when we talk about innovation, in the country, if you ask me, what we require is not just invention, but innovation. That means not just a discovery in a laboratory, but translational research which takes it to the patient. And therefore, I'm very happy, Deepak, Dr. Bonde, and all your team, that you are focusing on translational research so that the benefits can go to the patients. And there, in terms of India, what we require is what I like to call as assured innovation. What is assured? It is A-S-S-U-R-E-D. Each letter has a significance. A is affordable. India is a poor country. So therefore, it should not just be affordable, it should be extremely affordable. Today, India has 1 billion mobile. Why? because it is extremely affordable. Anybody can afford it. And of course, now voice has become free, as you all know. So affordability. The second is scalability. There is no use creating something which will help 10 people, 100 people, 1,000 people. It must help 10 million people. Okay? So how do you scale? The third is sustainability. Sustainability on three counts. The first count is economic. You can't live on the subsidies of the government and make a successful business. It has to be a standalone. The second is environmental. For example, if you look at plastic pouches, they're affordable. But are they environmentally sustainable? No. And third is social. It has to be socially acceptable. And therefore, when it comes to stem cell, that is the biggest challenge that one has. And that is why all the ethics has to sort of go behind it, so that people get assured that it will not be misused. So that is the S. So we are dealt with affordability, scalability, sustainability. The next one is user-friendly. Why has smartphone picked up, even among illiterate people? Because they don't have to type. It's a touch. And even now, voice, that can make a difference. And therefore, Deepak, when we are coming, we are talking about the fact that you don't have to do a surgery, but use stem cell, because surgery, you told me about the morbidity that we have, that is user-friendly. That is the U part of it. R is rapid. Okay, you have demonstrated the rapid way of decision-making, the rapid way of constructing a laboratory, and today we are inaugurating in the fastest possible time. So it is not only the rapidity of process, but rapidity of product. The way that product is designed to respond. In my mother's name, I have created what is called as Anjani Mashelkar Inclusive Innovation Award. November 17, we give it on that day, because that is the day she left us. And I don't give it to best practice. I give it to next practice. And this year's award went to Navin Khanna, who created the dengue test. Dengue test used to take days. What he did was to do it in 15 minutes. And today he has 80% of the market share, by the way. That is what I mean by rapidity. Okay? Then what comes is excellence. E is excellence. Then you would say, come on, you are joking. What is affordable can't be excellent, and what is excellent can't be affordable. But that's what India does, by the way. And that is why, Dr. Patil, your aim in life of giving affordable excellence that I saw everywhere, you know, as I was going through the facilities, that means it should be used even by a common man, although the quality is that of Germany and the rest, basically. In the same way, our therapeutics, you talked about therapeutics, you talked about surgeries, etc. They have to be, on one hand, affordable, on the other hand, excellent. That is E. And finally, D, it has to be distinctive and hopefully disruptive. Distinctive because we are, you know, too involved in creating things which are me too. And we take great pride in saying, oh, first time in Shukravarpet, first time in Pune, first time in Maharashtra, first time in India, sorry. It has to be the first time in the world. How do we actually create it? So Deepak, to you and your team, my guide will be assured innovation, which reaches the patients. A is affordable. There is a charge that we must make it affordable. Scale, Dr. Patil, the benefits must go to the whole country. Next is sustainable on these three grounds that I said, economical, environmental, and social. All right, user-friendly, and we talked about it, how that can be user-friendly. Rapidity, speed is something that this Vidyapit is proud of, in terms of not only decision-making, but in terms of delivering excellence of technology. Of course, we are talking about the latest, and you have given them the latest tools. And D, distinctive, differentiate yourself. just like stem cells differentiate themselves, your research must differentiate itself from the rest of the world and be ahead of the rest of the world. All that I would say is that today we are laying down the foundation of assured innovation, not just for India, but for the whole world. I would like to end by saying Dr. Patil was very kind to mention that I completed 75 years. Yeah, 1st January, I did complete 75 years. But you know, a point in life comes when you keep on adding years to your life. But then a day comes when you add life to your years. So today I can tell you, I'm 75, I've added 25 years to my life. So Deepak, here is the proposal. You will celebrate the silver jubilee of Regenerative Medicine Laboratory. Please do call me 25 years. I'll be around, all of you will be around. Thank you.